Let's give it up for our next TED-like talk.
Good morning, everyone. And I'm Shipra. I'm the director of user research at UCC. And as a researcher, I get a lot of opportunities to move away from my desk, travel to places where the action is, and listen to stories of people, stories that matters to them, stories about who they are, what they want to become, what are their aspirations like, what are their motivations, what are some of the blockers because of which they're not able to achieve what they would like to. And all of this becomes furthermore interesting because at UCC, we take up projects that are pretty domain agnostic in nature, which means today we might be helping a healthcare, somebody in a healthcare industry to see if how we can manage our diseases better, or how can a medtech device save our lives better, to probably help somebody in a real estate to design the next gated communities by understanding who are we as people, how do we live as families and societies, or help somebody in the fintech space to help save for this through children education better. So because of the kind of work we do, we get a lot of opportunities to plug ourselves in this various context and not be siloed, the word that Mahesh used, in just working and focusing only on one sector and one product at a time. And because of this unique advantage that we have, we get to study and understand of what is happening at a society level. What are we becoming as people? What are these different layers that we're navigating to achieve what we want to? And while every research that we do has, like anybody would do a research, you will need to have specific objectives, very defined inquiry areas. And our work is pretty exploratory in nature because the outcomes always are expected to help our clients take some strategic decisions, which means we need to go, while there's a set inquiry area, we're not restricted by that because we want to see what are the other things that we may not know of already. And while we explore in those little areas that we are open for exploration, not everything may turn out to be as relevant to the client. But there may be very interesting observations that may intrigue us, that may confuse us. But because those are not really a part of that particular research objective, we park those. We park those in our kitty and revisit those when we find time between our projects. And when we do this experiment, some of them lead us to something that's worth chasing further. Others may sometimes just help us validate what we already know or bring us some more nuanced scenarios. One of such work that we've been doing at UCC for the last one and a half year is to see if there's an opportunity for us to decode the tech savviness levels of the emerging segments of India. And what I'm going to present to you today is what we have done so far. It's an interesting place that we are at, and there is more work to be done, but I think everybody in the room who are thinkers, creators, problem solvers can be benefited with this perspective that we have arrived at. And the need of doing this was sensed when we saw that within this large profile user segment that we define as next billion users, emerging segments, people who are at a certain, who live in a certain socioeconomic segments in certain smaller towns and villages, the profile seemed to be something that we understand. It seemed that we know who these people are, and but when we start to interact with them, we start to study them in depth, we saw there was a variation. Not everybody within that large cohort was leveraging the technology the way we thought they were, the way we thought we were designing for them, because we probably knew who they are. And that kind of got interesting because this got repeated irrespective of the sector, be it entertainment, gaming, healthcare, to fintech. We saw that the patterns were repeating, and that's what led us to where we are. And because I'm a storyteller, I'm somebody who spends a lot of time connecting with people, listening to their stories, I'll share a few with you here. So let's meet Meera. Meera is a washwoman. She lives in Mumbai, and she's a sole bread earner in the family, and she has a daughter who's going to a college. And while Meera has her little phone that she uses to stay connected, stay entertained, and maybe, you know, scroll a little bit of social media now and then to see what's happening, but that's usually passive in nature. From her friends, she learned that there's a way for her to find her next job online, but when she started to explore, it wasn't as easy and straightforward. So she had to wait for her daughter to help her do this, and only with her help and support she could find her next job, because navigating through these complex systems of understanding where to start, how to filter information, how to make the next progress is something that she did not find herself fit to do. Which means somebody like Meera, who can take advantage of technology, did do it eventually, would have not done without the help and support of a daughter. Next, let's move to Indore. So Rajesh is a tuition teacher, and like most of us during the lockdown, realized that maybe there is a need for a more passive income. He started to look out for areas of what can he do beyond what he is already aware of to start to make this little passive income. So he spent time to study the stock market. He started with the books that seemed to be the most easy resource for him. And when he did that, he felt it was restricted, and he started to explore the internet. He spent an entire year to curate information, filter it, train himself, educate himself, and start to make this investment. Now he's doing it successfully, but the point is he spent an entire year to start from zero to make some action. Next, meet Hira Lal. Hira Lal is an 85-year-old gentleman. He has a lot of free time at his hand, and he loves to watch videos. But he loves to revisit some of the videos that he liked. And while his granddaughter has taught him many times how to create a playlist, how to revisit the videos he likes, it seems to be impossible for him. Now, somebody in this room would not even think that creating a playlist and revisiting can be a huge task. So while this is just entertainment, it's a big deal for Mr. Hira Lal. And despite of having been trained multiple times, he always finds himself pretty overwhelmed and confused, and he quits the job. The task of, you know, and he moves on to watching whatever comes to him. And only when his granddaughter is around, he can revisit the videos that he wishes to watch. My life story is from my personal account. So she's Preeti, 25 years old, and she came to me asking, "Didi, I want to buy a new phone. Please suggest me which one can I buy." Now, with my limited understanding of what she might want, I stereotyped her and I said, gave her an option which is more of mid to low medium range of phone, thinking affordance was a big thing. And when I suggested one to her, she said, "Nahi didi, mujhe badhiya wala phone chahiye. Mehenga bhi hoga to chalega." I said, "But why do you want to spend? You know, you already have a little daughter, your son is going to school, you have other expenses." So what she said was very interesting. She said, "Dekhiye didi, beti badi ho rahi hai, uski photo khichni hai, memories banani hai. Beta padhai kar raha hai, internet यूज कर लेगा पढ़ाई के लिए. हम सारी फैमिली साथ में बैठकर मूवी देखेंगे. मैं घर वालों से वीडियो पे बात कर लूँगी. आपको ये करना होगा तो बड़ा सा टीवी है, सबके रूम में एक टीवी है, बढ़िया सा कैमरा है, दो दो फ़ोन है, स्मार्ट वॉच है. हमारे लिए ऐसे नहीं होता है, हमारे लिए ऑल इन वन होता है. सो यू नो दैट एंड शी सेड इफ इट्स एक्सपेंसिव इट्स ओके, इट हैज़ टू गिव मी ऑल द एक्सपीरियंस दैट आई वॉन्ट. That got me thinking that, you know, how integral technology has become for people to live the lives that they want, and how beautifully it has democratized this entire, you know, the age that we're living in. You, me, or Preeti, any of us can have the same phone, irrespective of where you are sitting, right? So, but I don't know the way you and me will use that phone. Will Preeti be able to use it the same way and leverage it to the way that we would like to? And because of these many stories that we came across, we spent time back at our UCC studio to see what is really changing. What is that evolution that we are going through, which we kind of miss because we're too busy with our day-to-day jobs. So we paused, and what we did was we pulled out all these stories that were hinting us towards something, but we were not sure of. So it was the first time that we went back to all the stories that we collected. When I say stories, take it as interviews and research discussions, home visits to shadowing them, you know, using this. So because we are more exploratory in nature, we use a lot of ethnographic methods that gives us opportunity to understand people in depth. And so we pulled out about 380 such transcripts and videos and audios, and we revisited those, included both men and women, people from the age group of about 18 years onwards to 50 plus, living in different parts of India, about 85 locations in total, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 cities and smaller towns and villages across all the four zones. And this is something that's very interesting, because whenever people say, I want to study India, we always suggest you need to cover all the four zones. There's nothing like one India, right? So the differences matters a lot, and we made sure that we include all of those. And the people whom we covered within this were people who were busy with such occupations, from, you know, homemaker to a student, to a driver, to electrician, carpenters, engineers, to salesmen. Some people were, you know, receptionists, to telecallers. So the range was pretty wide, from somebody who was a student to somebody who's a data operator, right? And they were using these different types of phones. And I was surprised to see there were some iPhones too, and we went back and checked. They said it's easy to get it on EMI, and this cohort does have those kind of phones. So the attempt was to bring all of these people and also see in which scenarios were they using the technology. Here being the phone, that is the most important device to use the tech. So we pulled out our research work that were focused around entertainment, communication, to do something to do in healthcare, education, transportation. And because we had a lot of data at hand, we did not go out and look for more, because this was the first test to see, is it even worth chasing something that we think is interesting out here? So, and I think this was a great start. We had a good spectrum, and when we did all of that, our research, our multiple levels of synthesis indicated that the tech savviness is as diverse as its culture and geography of India. It is possible to further segment the users whom we right now very casually blanket under next billion users, the emerging segments. And this is where we arrived at. We have identified that there are three sub-segments: the hesitants, the explorers, and the navigators. And the hesitants, and very one interesting thing is, we thought that maybe with little bit of training, practice, experience, will these people move to become the next category? It doesn't seem like that. They will remain to be hesitant, they will remain to be explorers, and they will remain to be navigators. So it's not a progressive behavior that we are seeing. And I think that is what was missing in our start of the briefs that we started to receive from the clients, where we thought all of them are same, and with little bit of nudging and giving them experiences to self-learn, they will become another. They will move to become more advanced. That's not really the case. So the digital hesitant is somebody who's probably never been to a school or have dropped out even at the very lower levels of their education. They don't really need technology, but because there's a phone, they use it for, you know, a little bit of calling and messaging. Mostly passive consumption, whatever comes to them, they use, because they do not know how to start looking for stuff. That's never been a behavior that they're used to, because in the real world, whatever they want, they go and get, or it comes to them. And they're restricted by the language, they're restricted by the complexity, and the fear that I do not want to go wrong because I don't know how will I correct it, they stay limited in how they consume technology. And audio is one of the best interaction methods. It's very easy for them to look for the regional content on YouTube, something that they want to probably, you know, get little help on. Speak on, use their audios for messaging, for searching, and maybe if they have to respond to others on messages, it's audio messages that they send, or very cryptic little letters put together which may have some phonetic understanding of what they're trying to say. The second one is of digital explorers. These are people who have attained at least a little bit of education levels. They're at least, you know, 10th or 12th level pass, and they take up little jobs which may need a little bit of more cognitive abilities to perform little complex jobs. They use it for communication, entertainment, and for online work. And when they are using it for messaging, they use it for both. While they use audios, they also are able to use text texting. And it could either be in English or their regional language. But when they're using the regional language, usually the Roman scripts that they use. And I think all of us know of how we are comfortable saying "aap nahi aa rahe ho" using your, the Roman script. And while they are somebody who understands how they would like to use technology, because they are yet not equipped to handle the complexity, like they cannot yet create their profiles, they cannot yet create their resumes, but once that is done, and they pay people to get this for them, like it's a real thing, people pay others to create their profiles, to create their resumes, and once that is done, he knows how to navigate. So he's very, they're very aware of how they can leverage technology. They know what are the shortcomings, and they look and outsource those jobs, get that done, and then move forward. Which means, unlike the hesitants, they are exploring, and they are making use of technology a little more than what they would have if they did not have a support system, right? So which means there's a rescue. There are people who can help them. And the last one, this I think I spoke, so I'll just move from here. The last one is of digital navigators. They are on the higher end spectrum of these three categories that still belong within the next billion users or the emerging segments. And these are people who have better levels of education. They are graduates. They can use multiple devices beyond just a phone. They use their laptops, they use their smartphones. Some of them also have their smartwatches. And they do more proactive work. They know this is a tool where I can start to learn, I can start to upgrade myself. They take up jobs where using the phone or the computers is important to perform their jobs. They're data operators, they're people who might help in, your travel bookings and stuff like that, where they can take instructions, they can use technology, they have language that they can leverage on and finish their jobs. They're not somebody who will be dependent on their peers to suggest them what to do. Like in the previous one, we know that with a little bit of support, they could achieve their jobs. But these guys, they know how to filter the noise. They know how to start to use the rating systems and make a decision, and then use stuff that they would want to leverage of whatever they want to do, be it professional or personal or entertainment. And I think we have understood only this category well, and we've been designing for them, and we have not really spent time to understand the hesitants or the explorers. And where we have arrived at is that just understanding these three segments at this level is not sufficient. We will need to contextualize in the areas that we are working in. Maybe somebody in the fintech space will need to understand a hesitant more better, and that learning may be very different than somebody who's trying to understand a hesitant in the healthcare space. So the discussion here is that once you identify who your target audiences are within this next emerging segment, maybe once you spend more time to understand them, we will be able to make products that may help people feel more empowered, more confident, use it more efficiently, and feel secure when they're performing these jobs and tasks that they want to achieve. And the only way I know to do this is using your empathy, because all our work is empathy-driven research, and which really means that we need to start to understand who these people are, where they are, why they're doing certain things better than the others, or are being left out from this entire big evolution that we are going through. We need to step out from our comfort of our, your AC rooms, your boardrooms, and actually go on field, listen to them, see how they are performing their jobs, see who's helping them do it, what are those conditions, what does the space and the room that they perform this task looks like, what are some of the things that are comforting to them versus the others. And unless and until we don't do that, we will start to think that we know these people, we will start to believe that they are, if I am doing 10%, the others may do 50%, so let me just, adjust that and design stuff for them. So my urge is that start to move out from your desk, start to connect with people, identify who your target segments are,
chase them further, and maybe that is when we can start to understand who these three segments are and design better. And this is my team who's been behind all the work we've been doing. And I would like all of you to treat this as a conversation starter, right? We do not have anything yet in the Indian space, in the Indian market, to say, is there a way to segment the tech savviness of the emerging segments? Whatever work we've done, we've arrived until here. There is more work to be done, and it is a continuous work that's going to happen back at our studios. And we will start to share more. But whenever you find opportunity, please start to look and get more closer to whom you are really working for. Thank you for your time and thanks for your attention. Yeah, so what he asks is there a way, is there a place where we can find a detailed report? We are working on it. And because we do all this work between our projects that the clients commission us, it is a little slow, but we know that something more has to happen. And it's work in progress. Maybe next couple of months we will have something more to share, because a lot of it stays in our head, and within the team we know where it's going. But once we start to share out, I know there has to be more background and more detailed understanding. Couple of months and I think we will have something to share with you.
Hello. Yeah, thanks for a beautiful presentation.
Thank you.
I wanted to understand from the research perspective, we talk about a lot of AI, right? It just gives everything to you. You'd say persona, customer journey, whatever, right? How much does this connect with the AI, and is the AI going to disrupt what you're doing?
I have been thinking about this, and I don't know if I have the right answer. But what I know as a researcher is, as you mentioned, forward-looking. We look into the future. We don't. The purpose of doing research is because we don't know. And AI works on what we know. It gets smarter with what we have fed. It doesn't know what's not lying out there already. So while I know that it can help us speed up our process, I am not too sure if it can start to decode the way the human mind does, because we are using a lot of our cognitive senses, multiple at a time, to catch those, you know, undercurrents. And that is what I think is our superpower, like empathy, catching those undercurrents, which I am not too sure if right now AI is going to help us do that. It can definitely mash up things that are already there and give you stuff that are ready to use within of how you want to consume. Because I did test it sometimes. It has no conscious, right? It has nothing to, like when you and I are going to get into a discussion, we will have our points, we will debate and fight and we'll stick to our points. AI will not do that right now. It will keep pleasing you and it will manipulate the way it wants you to. So right now, I'm not too confident of using it. Maybe in future, yes.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your time.